Today's Portswigger tutorial is entitled Client-Side Prototype Pollution in Third-Party Libraries. This lab is vulnerable to client-side prototype pollution. To solve the lab, we must deliver a payload to the victim that calls alert.document.cookie in their browser. We will first solve the lab by using the recommended Dumb Invader extension and then see a short demonstration on how we could do this manually. In order to use Dumb Invader, we need to use Burp's built-in browser. Open Burp Suite, go to Proxy, Intercept, and click the Open Browser button. In the browser, open the vulnerable lab. Now, from the browser's installed extensions, select Burp Suite. Set Dumb Invader to on. Then, go to the Attack Types tab and also set Prototype Pollution to on. Click the Reload button. Dumb Invader automatically checks the page for sources that enable you to add arbitrary properties to any built-in prototype. To see the results, open the Developer Tools by pressing F12. Go to the Dumb Invader tab and select Dumb. Dumb Invader has identified two potential techniques for polluting the object.prototype. Press the Test button for the first one. Dumb Invader opens a new tab in which it adds an arbitrary property to the object.prototype. To test that this worked, open the Developer Tools. The object.prototype has already been queried. As you can see, it contains the test property property. Now create a new object, let my object equals an empty object, and check if it inherited the test property, my object.test property. We have confirmed that prototype pollution is indeed possible. Go back to the previous tab and click the Scan for Gadgets button. After the scan finishes, open the Developer Tools again and go to the Dumb Invader tab. As you can see, Dumb Invader has identified the Set Timeout Sync. We can click the link for the stack trace. Then go to the console tab and open the last link printed in the stack trace. This will send us to the JavaScript file where the sync was found. Back in the Dumb Invader tab, we can also click the exploit button to automatically generate a proof of concept exploit. A new tab is opened and an alert function is called. All we need to do now is to deliver this link to the victim by using the provided exploit server. Click the Go to Exploit Server button. We are going to add some JavaScript to the body section of the page. We want the victim to be navigated to the malicious URL automatically when they click on our exploit link. To do this, we say script location equals our malicious URL and script. Let's also click the store button to make sure that our changes are saved. To simulate the victim and make sure that our exploit works, just copy the link for the page and paste it in a new tab. As you can see, we are automatically being redirected to the malicious URL. Back on the exploit server page, change the message of the alert from 1 to document.cookie, as per the instructions of the lab. Finally, click the Deliver Exploit to Victim button, and the lab is solved. Now, if you are up to it, I figured we could quickly look over finding client-side prototype pollution gadgets manually. First, we need to identify a source that lets us add arbitrary properties to the object.prototype. The first place we look for pollution sources is the URL. In previous labs, we polluted the object.prototype by using a query string. This time, we know that we need to use a hash string. So we will say hash underscore underscore proto underscore underscore dot foo equals bar. Open the developer tools and query the object.prototype. This did not work. Let's try the square brackets notation. Hash underscore underscore proto underscore underscore square brackets foo equals bar. This time, we can see that we have indeed managed to pollute the object.prototype. Now that we have our source, we need to find the pollution gadget. This is any property that we can pollute that is passed into a sink without proper filtering or sanitization. For this, we must look through all of the JavaScript files the application uses. We would go to Debugger, Resources, JS, and look through the files one by one. Because we've already solved the lab, we know that the gadget is found in the first file, which looks like a Google Analytics tracker. Looking through the code, we would at some point arrive at this function definition. Function va, a, comma, b. This function is used to add properties to the UA object. Scrolling down, we see the properties anonymize IP, currency code, title, all the way to hit callback, which, if you remember from earlier, is the gadget we are interested in. However, not knowing this, we would have to test all of the properties one by one and see if any of them is getting passed to a sink, such as eval. To do this, we will use the steps enumerated in the Port Swigger documentation. First, go to Burp and select Proxy, Proxy Settings. In the Settings section, scroll down and make sure Burp is also intercepting responses by checking Intercept Responses based on the following rules. Now, turn Intercept to on. Go back to the browser and refresh the page. Burp is now intercepting every request the browser is making, as well as all of the responses it receives from the server. Click the Forward button until you see the response that loads the JavaScript file we are interested in. Here, we will add a debugger statement, script, debugger, and script. Click forward again and then stop intercepting traffic. Click on the Intercept is on button to toggle it to off. Back in the browser, the debugger statement should have paused the execution of the script. In the console tab, add this provided code, object.define property, and so on. This code defines a getter for the property your property on the object.prototype. Whenever the script tries to access this property on any object, the getter function will be executed. In this case, the getter function logs a trace to the console and returns the string polluted. Let's try it with one of the properties we've seen declared earlier, anonymize IP. Press Enter. Then press the button to continue the execution of the script. No stack trace appears, so the property was never accessed within the application. We would now have to do this test for every property we encounter within the JavaScript files of the application. Let's assume we got to the hit callback property. Repeat the previous process. Turn intercept to on, refresh the page, click forward until you see the response that loads the JavaScript file we are interested in, add the debugger statement to the top of the page, click forward again, turn intercept to off, and go back to the browser. In the console tab, change the anonymize IP property to hit callback. Click enter and continue the execution of the script. This time, we get an error. This means that the application tried accessing the property. We have a potential prototype pollution gadget. Let's click the error and see what the problem is. We see these lines, var c equals a.getTC. And set timeout c, 10. If we scroll up a bit, we also see that tc equals hit callback. We've just defined a getter for the property hit callback on object.prototype, and in that getter function, we return the string polluted. So now a.get of tc returns polluted. This means that the set timeout is being called with polluted as its first argument instead of a function. Therefore, we get the error, the fix is easy, just change the getter so it returns a function instead of a string, let's say alert. Of course, we need to go through the tedious task of intercepting the request again, adding the debugger statement, and so on. When this is done, define the getter function again and change the polluted text to alert. Click enter, continue the execution of the script, and an alert pops up on the page. This means that we've found our prototype pollution gadget. All that's left to do now is to pollute the found property by changing the URL hash to proto hit callback equals alert. Copy the link, paste it in a new tab, and you should see the alert. To solve the lab, we must again craft the exploit using the exploit server like we've done at the beginning of this lab, but I'll leave that up to you. This is it for today's tutorial. See you next time.